Good evening. My name is Leroy Brown, and welcome to another taping of Bridging the Gap. Tonight is going to be a very special taping because it is a tribute to Ms. JoAnn Robinson. But before we get into her, because there's a lot of good things going to be said by Ms. Robinson, I'm sure everyone by this time has known Ms. Robinson passed. So I'm going to let everyone here tell us who they are and what part they played in Ms. Robinson's life and what part Ms. Robinson's life played with them. Ms. Everett, I'm going to start with you. Tell us who you are, what role you played in the HEART organization.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone. My name is Nancy Ebers, and I met Ms. Robinson about 13 years ago. My son had a court date here in Bolingbrook, and I remember standing before the judge with him and crying, not knowing what was going to happen. And then the judge told us that there was an opportunity for my son to do community service and that we needed to speak with a woman named Miss Robinson. So we were ushered into her little office and she looked my son up and down and said, "Well, you clean up pretty good, son. How are your grades?" And it was amazing. I felt hope that there was a way he could turn his problem around. When the classes were held, I went with him. We were invited, the parents were invited to sit there. So I went and got to see the program firsthand. Mm-hmm. It was amazing. It was very, very helpful. And later on, I offered to volunteer with the program as staff assistant. So I've been doing that for about 11 years.
Wow. Kenny, you were a student with the HEART organization. Can you tell us a little about how that worked for you?
Yes, sir. It was, she was really strict with you, but it's because she loved you and she wanted you to be successful and she wanted you to pass her class. She wanted you to do big things in life and she always wanted to know what you were doing. She always wanted you to come in and check up on her and always tell her how you were doing, always wanted to make sure you were staying out of trouble, always just wanted to know. It was like tough love with her. She would be on you the whole way until you were successful. She wanted you to succeed in life and she wanted you to do good and not make bad choices and end up in jail or something.
That's very good. We're going to get more into that a little later on. Rios, tell us how you got involved and who you are.
My name is Anthony Rios. I was a student of the program roughly 10 years ago. I love the program, love Miss Robinson. I went in there, I think I was like throwing eggs at cars with my friends, and got into the program for disorderly conduct and realized that you can do much cooler stuff than throw eggs at cars. And Miss Robinson really like took me under her wing and she to show me what it's like to be a cool human being. And then throughout the years, my brothers had gone through the program and I just kept coming back here and there, helping out when I could, setting up chairs, setting up tables. And one day I went back and I just didn't stop going because I just loved the program. I loved the mission. I saw what she was doing. I understood what she was doing. I believed in what she was doing and I wanted to do it too. So for the past few months, I really sat under her as a mentee. And I feel blessed and lucky and honored and humbled to have been so close to her in the last few months to learn as much as I can.
And we're going to get in to tell you exactly who this lady was. May you be very surprised. Dr. Leonard, I mean, you played a major part in this whole program and a number of different. First, tell us exactly how a young person would wind up in the program in the first place, and how does that look?
Well, the majority of our children come from the court, their court order, as an alternative to a more severe punishment, with the caveat of having whatever offense expunged from their record so it doesn't track them throughout their life and hinder their ability to be successful. So that's how most of the children come. Although we do have parents who send their children for various reasons, sometimes rebellion, insubordination, or they have heard the miracle that was being wrought at the Heart Organization. So that's how most of our children come into the program. Therefore, my history with JoAnn, we would need a whole program for that because it goes back so far, almost as far as your own. But JoAnn came across me. I have an institute, the Anger Management Institute of Chicago, and she did some Google and found my website and invited me to be on her program. Those were the days where she was still doing her Oprah Winfrey show. And we sat around and we talked, and she asked questions. I tried my best to answer them, et cetera, et cetera. And from there, it was just a spontaneous camaraderie, you see. She asked, well, Dr. Ingram, I know I can't afford your fee. I said, it's okay. Your heart will pay the difference. And that's been, oh my goodness, 17, 18 years ago. And I'm happy that I was here for the full ride. Mm-hmm. And we hope to continue the vision and the work.
And that was going to be one of the questions that I'll ask later on is, what direction is the Heart Organization going to go on now that Ms. Robinson isn't here? She's here in spirit, but we know to do her injustice would to let this program go. Ms. Everett, tell us who JoAnn Robinson really is, you know, who she was. You know, I've been around her for about 18 years, and I know this woman's like a general. I think I'd be more afraid of a general than I would be her.
Yes.
You know, tell us who she really was.
Yes, you're right, like a drill instructor. But there was kindness, too, and caring, and loved, a great sense of style. Really encouraged the students to look their best. I had a gift for that. She took good care of her staff, thanked us constantly. Yeah. I remember her walking up to me saying, Nancy, if I haven't told you lately, I appreciate you being here. You know, she would do the same for you and the students too, just that she would encourage them constantly to be their best. I remember back when the class was meeting in the courtroom, Bolingbrook courtroom. It was just different being in the court, of course, because it puts people on edge. But somehow, class was held there. Students on one side, any parents that came to visit would be on the other side. And I remember watching her during one of the times when you were speaking, Dr.
Yes, yes.
And she would just walk up to a student and hand on the shoulder, like, how you doing? Taking good notes?
Yes.
You know, it was that kind of thing that I believe the students needed, still need. And she taught us how to encourage. That's the heart is helping, well, enriching, but I always said, hey, Ms. Robinson, it's encouraging too.
Yes.
Advising, reaching, and teaching. That was her heart.
Kenny, how did Ms. Robinson change your life? Apparently she changed your life. You look like a rock star right now. So
thank you.
How did she change your life?
She showed me what the real world is about. It's not just a joke and playing around. It is serious. Like, you can have fun, but you just have to know when your limits are and when not to do something bad. She always taught us, like, she always showed us videos of kids going to jail and, like, showing us what it's like out there, and it's not nice. Ms. Robinson, she was just always there and always wanted you to succeed. She didn't want you ending up like any of those people. She just wanted you to make smart decisions and be good, go along, do good things.
I know I've spoke at her, you know, her classes about maybe 12 times. And each time you go there, you learn something new from this lady. You know, and I realize you've worked with her, you've gone through the program. How did she impact your life? How did she change your life? Yes.
She cared. She cared. Like, the world is an interesting place in the sense that, you know, parents, they go off and they go to work to support us kids, and we don't see that at the time. So to be in a program with Ms. Robinson is like, you know, I'm an adult who cares about your well-being, and it's like parents have to go off and do their thing, but she was just an adult who stayed back and helped kids stand up. And she supported me, like, she really did. It was awesome. I started my own company just off of, sorry, I'm getting emotional. Using her as a template for what a good director is. So, yeah.
Well, I'm sure we could have so much talking about Ms. Robinson. Dr. Nell, your role in the program itself, because you've gone all over the country and you spoke to young men, young women, how to change their life. How did that work with you with JoAnn Robinson? Because she was, in fact, the dominant. She was the control person. How did that work for you, you being a doctor and all?
It was a glove fit. It was Ms. Robinson was the other wing of a real therapeutic and rehabilitative process, you see. It takes head and heart. She had that heart. And I was just really listening to these confessions here, and everyone in some shape, form, or fashion are testifying to the fact that Ms. Robinson gave everyone who came through the door, whether staff or student, the experience of being loved. You see, care is not quite a strong enough word, you see, because that could be mere sympathy, armchair. Her love was hands-on. And being a psychotherapist, I know from experiences that that's the most healing experience any human being can have, is the experience of being loved and validated in spite of their imperfection, shortcomings, and fault. And Ms. Robinson had this unique ability to do that, to convey that experience to all those who came in contact with her. In addition to that, she was gifted. You see, a person that does what Ms. Robinson has been able to do with her lifetime, that's a gifted person, you see. And part of her genius and gift was she had a near photographic memory and recall down to the details, you see. And that became an advantage in dealing with staff and students because very detailed, you see. Not just in terms of how you dress, but psychologically, emotionally, how you feel it, you see. Very detailed. And of course, even after the students left, the love was mobile. The care was mobile because every student gets a birthday card. She does that personally. I just dropped a bunch in the mail today. She sits at her kitchen table with her coffee and her Panera sandwiches and soup. And she sends out cards to everyone who's been through that program. To date, we're around 3,000. So that gives you an idea of what she did with her downtime. There was no downtime. Every minute, every hour, unless she was sleeping, was about the heart organization in some shape, form, or fashion. And I might add parenthetically that it wasn't confined to Bolingbrook because I had similar programs in Chicago, same thing. And some of our children who moved out of Bolingbrook moved into the city, I came upon them in my own network, and it was always the same thing. How's Mrs. Robinson? So it's that kind of effect that justifies a lifetime. Ms. Robinson made legacy, and she did it with class and style and humor and with some toughness, true? So it was a trifecta. So I'm just happy to be sitting here today to be able to share with those who have not had the experience of that phenomenon called JoAnn Robinson and give them a little bit of an idea of what it was all about. So I want to thank you personally for giving us this opportunity and making this tribute possible.
Well, I mean, I don't think we could ever do enough for Ms. Robinson. just for who she was. This lady was someone to be reckoned with because she had a sense of humor.
Yes, she did.
But she was one serious person.
Very.
One thing I know about Ms. Robinson is she is very protective of her children.
Very much so.
If you went around any of her children, she would ask you to leave until you had one of the staff members there. She was just so protective of them. You can tell she had tough love. And I'm going to ask Kenny about the dress code. Oh, my goodness, dress code. I kind of feel sorry for these young people when I'd walk in, and she had them standing in line like they were in a platoon. And she went down and expected every one of these people. You came in white socks, you're out of here. You know, if your tie wasn't right, you had a white. I mean, she was just so strict. But Kenny, tell us about that.
She wanted you to dress like you're professional. She didn't want any. You had to have dress socks. You had to have a belt, had to have a tie. I know I'm not wearing one, but I didn't have any at home. But if I did, I would have wore it. But she was really strict with how you came. She wanted you to look like you cared about coming, like show respect. It's all about the respect, especially your posture, the way you, how loud you were to them, like talking, looking them in the eyes. She was really like, she really wanted to see good people skills in people. And she taught me that a lot.
Mr. Brown,
yes.
May I add something about the dress
definitely.
Code comment?
Yes.
Yes, looking very professional. One time, I want to say maybe it was 08, 09, I'm not sure, but someone very generous donated tickets to a Bulls game. Thank you.
Thank you.
So she got a bus, and we went down to the United Center, and the students were in dress code. And after the game, we stopped at McDonald's, and people were saying, what is this, a group of lawyers? Young lawyers? Seriously.
Wow.
It was impressive.
She definitely made an impact on a number of people. Tell us some of the contributions Ms. Robinson made to Will County, DuPage County, Bolingbrook.
A contribution that she made is giving a piece of herself mm-hmm. to every individual she came in contact with. Mm-hmm. That's at the drive-thru. I was in the drive-thru with her at McDonald's, and she just made an effort to make sure the drive-thru people like were having a better day than before she arrived. And it's like giving a piece of herself to like Mr. Needham, to myself, to Ms. Ebers. Now everybody I come into contact with, it's, hey, I have this certain amount of positivity that came from Ms. Robinson. Now I have, by virtue of knowing her, the opportunity to share it with you. And it's like, what more contribution can you ask from such a classy, amazing human being? Like I said, everything she did, she was giving. She was sharing. She had the key. She figured it out. She figured out life, that it's not about billions and billions of dollars. It's about giving back. And she gave tenfold more than any human being I've ever met.
I know she surrounded herself with a number of high-profile people that could actually be role models for her students, because she wanted them to see the real world, how it looks. And I think it's safe to say here in Bolingbrook, you got Mayor Claire mm-hmm. and you got JoAnn Robinson.
Mm-hmm.
Just That's simple it. As that. Yeah. Everyone knew JoAnn Robinson,
yes.
You know, and she met no strangers at all. But I can imagine, Kenny, if she was out there, she'd go, where's your tie? You
yes,
know,
sir.
Right, you need to have it. But she's not, so you're okay.
We would have had a mock trial about this.
I'm sure we would have, right.
I would have had to pay $5.
$5.
True.
And I know Ms. Robinson, Doctor, and I'm sure you can really verify this. Ms. Robinson had young people that went through her program that are actually police officers.
Oh, yeah.
They're in politics.
Yes.
They got their own business.
Yes.
And they are working people that other people can say, my goodness, how did this happen?
Yes.
And it all came through the HEART program.
Yes, indeed.
I don't think we have enough time to actually talk about
really
Ms. Robinson and who she is or who she was and what she did to this country.
Yes.
You know, because
yes.
It wasn't just Bolingbrook.
Right.
It was all over. Everyone
all
knew
over.
Her.
All
Let's
over.
Let's talk about that, Doctor.
Well, you know, Ms. Robinson was an element. Something like sunlight, moonlight, wind, rain, pervading. Hmm? She was like a source of that energy. And charismatic, you know, to the nth degree. And her impact, as you well put it, was everywhere because it traveled. It's mobile. As Rios is saying, once she triggered that level of humanity in him, it just vibrates and it spreads to the next. And math and science, we call it the law of large number. You see, one good deed turns into a minimum of 400. So of the 3,000 students that have went through the program who have been touched, 400 more will hear about it. It's like seeing a good movie, you tell everybody.
Yeah.
And so it spreads like that with this process that she has called the heart. It's very difficult to capture with words, you see, that kind of a phenomena. I'm sitting here reminiscing, and it gets emotional.
Mm-hmm. And I can see that. I can see the emotion of the people that I've been in contact with in the last 2 days. When they started talking about Ms. Robinson, I'm talking about strong men, strong women,
yeah,
who started getting emotion, had tears in their eyes.
Oh, yes. Oh,
because
yes,
she made an impact on everyone's life.
Yes.
You know, and you just don't find people like that. She
very
was
rare.
One of a kind. There's no
very,
doubt. There will
rare.
Never be another Ms. Robinson.
No. And even the children that have grown up,
right,
and went forward in life, they're men and women with family. And, you know, one of the symbol of our bond is Kiyokaha. Which really means stay strong. And we see these children, and it was the ongoing thing between myself and JoAnn. I would take pictures and show them, here's another one of our children, here's another one of our children, and they would see us in the public. And that's the first thing, Kiyokaha. So we seen it in the theater. I was setting an interesting sidebar here. Once I was up at Denny's, right, and it was this guy sitting on the bench waiting to be seated, you see. I was coming to get something to go. Guy said he got this beard and everything, right? And he said, oh, hi, Dr. Ingram. You know, I said, hey, hi, how are you? I couldn't remember him, you see. He got a beard. And he said, how's Ms. Robinson? How's the program? I said, fine, you know, good, good. And I asked him, is that your son? It was a young guy sitting next to him, right? I said, your son, did he go through the program? I was inquiring. And he said, no, I went through. You see, he went through the program. And that tells you that's that sticks. You know, some things you hear go in one ear and out the other. But she planted some in your heart. That sticks. And they remember. And they remember. And I'm hoping that you all would tell stories about Ms. Robinson to your children. Mm-hmm. And they tell stories to their children. And this is how legacy unfolds. Mm. And what a great legacy.
Hmm? Dr. Ingram?
Go ahead.
Oh.
Go ahead. No,
just
go ahead.
Real quick, I'd like to echo a little bit of what you were saying when you were talking about the sun and the the wind and the rain. The phrase force of nature.
Force of nature.
Just comes to my mind when I think of Ms. Robinson.
Yeah.
Just that effective.
Yeah.
Very true.
Tell us, give us a typical night. Now, you meet on what, Tuesday nights?
Every Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday night.
And what was Friday night? I like that.
Everybody loves Friday night. Yeah. Everybody loves, because that's when she fed you. It was dinner and a movie night. We watch either Juvies or Locked Up or
Inside Statesville.
Inside Statesville, where
Scared
you don't want to be.
Scared
Straight. A lot of pretty wicked movies in regards to where you don't want to be. And she fed you. She did Popeye's Chick. Oh, her famous nachos.
Nachos, right.
Pizza.
Pizza, a lot of different places in the community she would bargain with and make deals. Popeyes, thank you. You guys always throw in some extra biscuits and jelly. Much appreciated. The pizza places.
McDonald's.
McDonald's, Famous Dave's. We didn't always have the money to go out and buy things. Sometimes she would have the students bring their own bag. And usually when she did that more than she liked to, she would do her famous nachos by the end of the program. So a lot of students were privy to that delectable taste.
Yeah, I know I went to one of her programs on a Friday night, and she goes, she'd always call me Deputy Mayor. Deputy Mayor? She goes, we got a movie. I think you might want to sit and watch it. I go, what is it, Ms. Roberts? She goes, it's called Scared Straight. Okay, I've heard about that movie. I have. And you want me to sit and watch this? I don't think so. Tell us, did you ever go through that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, tell us about
that. It was, It was interesting. It was, we watched both of them. There was two different ones. We watched both of them back to back, like next week. And I mean, the one of them was a lot more hard. Like the girls were a lot harder than the guys were. And the girls were all up in their face, spitting in their face, screaming at them. One of the girls was laughing, and one of the jail girls did not think it was funny, and it was something I would never want to be in.
Yeah. I think we could make a movie of Miss Robinson, a scared straight movie of
her.
and it would sell, I tell you what, it'd be a bestseller, you know, because I've seen some of these young people, how they were terrified of Miss Robinson. You know, she'd walk by them, and it's almost like they were statured, didn't want to move.
Mm-hmm. About that enrollment night especially,
yes.
Yeah. Was very tough.
Yeah.
And the parents were scared.
Yeah.
I was. I really was. Took some getting used to. But yeah, you talk about the movie Scared Straight, that one narrated by Peter Falk. Mm-hmm. I walked out the first time. I could not watch the whole thing. But over time, I'm guessing, maybe I've seen it in the, I don't know, 10, 12 years, several times. So I don't step out, but I still cry at some of it.
Tell us some of her quotes. You know, I know you know a number of them. I was just reading them last night.
I am committed.
Yes, tell us some of her quotes.
Well, she wrote the pledge of the I'm Committed pledge.
Right. Can you recite that pledge?
I believe I can. How about you, Kenny?
No, ma'am, not
anymore. I'll do my best. For all of you who are watching, you can just say it out loud, please. I am committed to accepting the consequences of my actions that have brought me to this program. I have only myself to blame. I am committed to leaving this program wiser, smarter, and more responsible than when I arrived. I am committed to learning and understanding all that I can about negative actions, bad choices, and how juvenile law and how my crime affects so many others. I am committed to believing in myself, keeping my head up, and not giving up when I make a mistake.
I am committed to my success in life.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. She used to tell the students, it's four little lines, you can do it.
Yes, and I remember the one, know the law.
Before the law knows you.
Oh, yes.
Know the law knows you. That I remember.
Remember that.
Yes, know the law before the law knows you.
My favorite was, bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye
now.
That was my favorite one.
Yeah, the words to live by.
Right.
She would say, some of our students graduate summa cum laude. I graduated God Almighty. I thought that was funny. And when somebody was wearing white socks when they shouldn't be, she would just go straight to Michael Jackson jokes, and she's just like, unless you're Michael Jackson, don't be wearing white socks.
Yes. We're going to show a tape of Miss Robinson when she was doing a promo for Mayor Claire. So please watch this.
Hi, I'm JoAnn Robinson, Director of the Heart Organization Community Service At-Risk Youth Intervention Program here in Bolingbrook, better known to everyone in Will County as the Community Service Lady. Again, Mayor Claire fits into my world, number one as a friend. Friend first. Good mayor second. Buddy third. Big dog fourth. Mayor Claire is Bolingbrook. Everything that Bolingbrook has become is because of Mayor Claire and the trustees, of course, that support him and the residents that support him. But this man had a vision that wasn't just talk. I've seen it come alive personally. That's where I fit in.
And I wanted to show that so people that didn't know Miss Robinson got a glimpse of who Miss Robinson was. You can tell in her voice she was very demanding. She was approachable, but very demanding. You know, and I've seen so much of her. This woman, everyone loves this woman. You know, you don't see where everyone loves someone like Miss Robinson, because she just had that appearance that I can be your friend, but I can also be your worst enemy. Mm-hmm. And when she would tell her students that, when she meant by that, I can be your worst enemy, I'm the one that's going to keep you, get you on, and keep you on the right track. And when you leave this program, you're not going to ever want to get in trouble again. Is that right, Kenny?
Yes, sir. Ms. Robinson, she would be on you so you didn't have to come back. She did it because she loved all of us. She loved each and every student as her own kid. No matter what they did, how they acted in class, she still loved them and still wanted them to succeed and be a better person and not have to come back to the heart program.
Ms. Everett?
Well, she would often refer to particular students as my son, my daughter.
Oh, yeah,
you know, she used that phrase and she meant it. She wished, you know, she would say, oh, I wish he was my real son, but he's like my son.
Yes.
And it was so respectful.
Yes. She planted seeds. She would call you doctor this, judge this.
President. She'd dress you up with a stethoscope.
Dress you up, you know, and plant seeds. And miraculously, some become doctors and some have become lawyers. Mm. So forth and so on. That's a skill.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm? That skill.
Along with it, she was such a great friend, a woman of faith.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I count her as a sister.
Yes.
And just faith is the substance of things hoped for, and yes. She mm-hmm. hoped for great things yes. in each of you.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, I met Ms. Robinson, I must say, maybe it was 20 years ago. And I met her in a church. I went to one of the ministers that ministers here in Bolingbrook, and I didn't know her at the time. And she was an evangelist. And I heard this woman in church, and I said, oh my goodness, you know, she's got to have a ministry somewhere, you know. And then I saw her as she moved on, because she always kept that God-fearing attitude about herself. And she tried to instill it and her children,
yes.
And I call them all her children because they were her children.
Indeed.
Because she would always say, when you drop your child off in my program, they're mine.
True.
When they walk out that door, they're yours again.
True.
And she meant that.
Of course.
And that's why sometimes she would tell the kids, where's your parents? Your parents not here? Bye. She wanted to make sure the parents understood the program
true.
As well.
True.
Now, you started a new program last night. How is that going?
It's going awesome in the sense that it's what Ms. Robinson, there's no hiccup, there's no whatever's happening behind the scenes. It's the ball's down, we pick it up and we keep running. And she had a bag of seeds, we pick it up and we just keep planting, we keep tilling, we keep growing, watering, sunlight, everything involved. And it's what, hands down, I know she would have wanted. And it's to continue her legacy. And that's what we're gonna do.
So Dr. How, and Ms. Everett, how are you guys going to move forward with this program? I'm sure there's a lot of questions out there, a lot of concern out there, because that's something we can't drop. We have to continue to grow and mentor these young people. Ms. Robinson did exactly that. As you can see, this young man, Ken, is sitting right here. How is that going to move? How is that going to go forward?
Well, it's going to go forward because, again, it's a force of nature. You can't stop that, you see. And everybody on staff there has been inspired with that same kind of vision and commitment to make that vision into a reality. There's going to be a meeting with the board of directors this Saturday so that make sure that the 501c3 stays intact and so forth and so on, and we'll make whatever changes are necessary. But as long as we're breathing.
The heart will go on.
The heart will beat.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's good. Okay, now, we know we lost a great lady. There's no doubt about that. They always ask the question, you know, anybody can be replaced. I beg to differ on this. Ms. Robinson can't be replaced. You know, Rios, I know you're going to do your best. I know you're going to, you know, try to take the level. Ms. Everett, I know you've been with her a long time, and you understand how this program works. And it's going to take a lot of strong people to keep it going in the
yes.
direction that she has it going.
Yeah.
Because she had everything upstairs, you know, and that's just the way it was. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to emulate someone that has it up here.
Mm-hmm.
It's not written down,
mm-hmm.
you know, so the village is going to be very supportive. You know, I'm sure all the courts, you know, I understand
yeah.
there are going to be a number of judges that's coming to
yes.
her service. Can you tell us something about her service as much as you can?
Well, tentatively, there's going to be a visitation on Tuesday. I believe it'll be somewhere between 4 and 7, 3 to 7, something like that, I think the family mentioned. And then the services per se will be on Wednesday. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there'll be some time in the evening giving everybody an opportunity to be there. There'll be a pre-pass. I'm not sure which of those days, but we'll have all that information and make it available to as many people as possible. And those who don't have that information, we'll leave a phone number. They can call Ms. Evers or Rios, and they can give them any clarification. And then an internment. Mm-hmm. I might want to add parenthetically that all of this facility and so forth and so on is what the mayor and your good self is doing. In fact, I got a text from the mayor before I came here. Wanted to make sure that everything in order. And that tells you the kind of impact JoAnn has. He's interrupting his meetings in Arlington to making sure that everything remains in place so that Ms. Robinson services and so forth and so on will not be diminished one iota. So that's the tentative schedule. And as I said, if anything changes or for more detail, just call the HART organization. Rios, you want to give them a number two as well if you're not there sitting at the desk at that moment? Maybe they can put it on the screen a little later. Something along that line.
Right. And I know they can go to the Bolingbrook web because they're going to put it on the Bolingbrook web once we have the finalization of everything. Yes, they'll go there so they can visit the Bolingbrook web and get the information as well.
Yes, yes, yes.
And I appreciate what her brother said, because the question was, are they going to send her back to Tennessee,
right,
you know, for the internment? And he said no.
Right.
She lived in Bolingbrook. She was a big part of Bolingbrook.
Right.
We keeping her here in Bolingbrook.
Right.
And I'm sure people will appreciate
that. That's right.
You know.
And in addition to that, Deputy Mayor, the family has also said this, like we feel. They feel it too, because, you know, you could recognize when a person is great because even their own family members will acknowledge that greatness, which is rare. You know, your own family members sometimes are the last people to recognize your gifts and so forth. That's not the case with Ms. Robinson's family. They recognize and realize this was an extraordinary person who happened to be our sisters, and testified that they saw that even before we saw it, because they grew up, you see. Ms. Robinson even conducted the services of her father when he passed, and they recognized during that presentation, this woman is extraordinary. And so they want this program to go. Mm-hmm. Her grandsons, Jonathan and so forth, they called me right before I got here. That's why I was running a little late. And they were saying, Dr. Ingram, this program has got to stay intact.
Right.
Families with us, you see, because they too had the experience of JoAnn Robinson, you see.
We got a number of young people out there that make bad choices, but Ms. Robinson makes sure that it's not held against them.
That's right.
And I used to always tell her when I would speak at her program, she said, Deputy Mayor, she go, what is that you know, saying that you always tell us, and it's never take a chance when you have a choice, because we all have choices.
Yes.
And she instilled that in her young people. You know, you don't have to get out there and do what other people are doing. You have a brain of your own, use it. You don't have to get out there because someone seemed like what they're doing is fun, but that kind of fun lands you in prison.
Mm-hmm.
She says, you're not going to prison because I'm going to stop it right here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that is just so strong for a person to say to children and young people that are growing up, because they always talk about children being our future.
Yes.
Yeah, that's true too. But children are also our present.
Absolutely.
We got to get them to the future first.
Absolutely.
Yes.
You know. That's true.
Which makes me think of another one of her sayings is keep the cuffs off kids.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. And in fact, in the beginning days, this kind of attention to details, to the actual psychodynamics of success, you see, because it's one thing to have a goal to be successful. It's another thing to have the competency to attain that goal. Ms. Robinson in the program provided both, gave you a goal and the competency to attain that goal. And we would actually go to the home of the kids in the old days with the parents. If they didn't come to the program, we would sit and we would identify the students. And of course, Mr. Salinas would be involved. He's a clinical psychologist, and we identify what might be blocking them from getting the most out of the program. We'll make home visits to that child's home, and we will sit down with those parents. And because it takes the village to bring these children across, and that includes the parents, because they don't know what to do either sometimes with these children. So that's the kind of extent that JoAnn was willing to go to for these children, you see. We used to have a personal thing between me and her, and I called her Isis, you know.
From Egypt.
Yeah, from Egypt. She was a great fan of that kind of history and so forth and so on. But one of the things that I thought justified calling her that is that instead of standing on the side and lamenting about the condition of young people and so forth and so on, JoAnn was that kind of person that would jump into the fray and grab that kid. Something like a hero. The real secret of her heart is she could identify with them. She know if he fails, she fails. And she wasn't about to fail. You see?
Right.
That's the hero impulse. You see, she was a hero or a chiro.
I am so glad you said that, Dr. Ingram, if I could talk just briefly here. We all have people who influence us, and some of them we refer to as mentors. And one time there was an event at the village. It was Joy Fest. And two or three of the students were volunteering to help out, pass out pamphlets and stuff. And I was with them. And Ms. Robinson was walking around enjoying the Joy Fest. And the students and I happened to sit near the village clerk, Carol Penning. Hi, Carol. And she said a wonderful thing to us about, she looked at the students and said, who are your mentors, really, you know? And right away, Ms. Robinson, you know, Dr. Ingram. But she said, they could be people you've met or maybe even haven't met. Think who they are. And that being said, now, I just want to add that my mentors, when I think of them, I could name plenty, but I just want to name three. Corrie ten Boom, who is was a survivor in World War II of a concentration camp, and she used her remaining years once she was freed and recovering. She went around teaching about love and faith and forgiveness. And another mentor I count is Mother Teresa, who helped the sickest of the sick and the poorest of the poor in India. And I think of Ms. Robinson.
Yes.
So I picture these three wonderful women, Corrie ten Boom, Mother Teresa, and Ms. Robinson. I'm sure they're all talking up there. Bless them. And JoAnn Robinson, I mean, she helped. I think of the phrase downtrodden.
Yes.
In many respects. Yes. But people who've lost hope. So she might not have necessarily helped the poorest of the poor, although, you know, there's disadvantages all around. And she wanted to give them an advantage and hope. Just awesome.
No, she was very supportive. I had was running a series of free community workshops in some of the troubled areas in the city, as you well know. Thank God we don't have that problem. You was asking what was one of JoAnn's major contributions. Mm-hmm. She decreased your crime rate significantly because she changed what was criminal in the kids that would have grew up to be your criminals. Yeah. So you can thank Ms. Robinson for whatever safety you are able to enjoy out here. Mm-hmm. And you're not going to see as much of that activity that you see in the city. They're not going to be on the corners running packs and so forth and so on. she had a lot to do with that. And I think that's one of your statistics that Mayor Claire is so proud of, that the crime rate has gone down. That don't happen by magic. That's not in the water. That's in the heart organization, doing what the heart organization does. We reverse criminality. And everybody is the beneficiary of that. But I was going to go on to say very quickly, was running these community workshops on managing and coping with anger in the city, in Lundale, in Humboldt Park, Little Village, Tarrytown, so forth and so on, all those hot spots. And she would sometimes say, Doc, you know, I can't get there, but here's, you know, some money, you know what I mean? Buy them something. Buy some books for them and stuff. So it was a big heart. I don't want to leave people with the impression that her heart was confined to the circumference of just Bolingbrook. Mm. This heart was big. And so she did what she asked other people to do, to support that work that is good, whether she was doing it or not. Mm. It was good work she supported. Mm. And that's a sign of greatness, don't you think?
Oh, it is. I mean, just like you say about the crime going down, Mayor Clara would always say, if every young man and young lady was involved in scouting, we wouldn't need a police force as we need it. That goes a little further. If every young man and woman was involved in the HEART program, we'd have the same statistics that are out there. This lady brought over 3,000 more kids through this program.
Yes.
And she had about, what, about a 93 or 94%?
97. We have a 3% recidivism.
Wow.
That's unheard of.
That's huge.
And that's why other communities now, of course, are seeking it out, DuPage County, Plainfield, because they want some of this. See how lucky we are here in Bolingbrook? You see, we becoming the mecca of solutions.
And just to add on that, so Mr. Miguel Salinas, the behavioral psychologist for VVSD, the school district, he actually was inspired by her to start his own program, which is the 3M Alliance. Mm-hmm. And the 3M Alliance starts in Jane Addams Middle School. And he started to teach kids who are in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade how to be mentors. Mm-hmm. And then he would take that group of kids and have him mentor the next group of kids that are 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. And that's going to have them mentor the next group of kids, the next batch of kids, the next batch of kids. Yeah. And it's like, if that could be duplicated throughout VBSD, then you're going to see that crime rate go even lower.
True.
You're going to see that connection in the community become that much stronger.
That's right.
Because of the template and the effect that Ms. Robinson had on him.
Yeah.
And after the middle schools, they go to high school.
Right.
So to duplicate that program into the high school, now you got people in the youth, like when they're really young, getting touched and starting to understand how to understand. Yeah. And then you get the high schoolers even deeper understanding working together. And then you've got such a strong, tightly knitted community that we're just all soldiers in positivity, whereas Ms. Robinson's the general. And
Well said.
I knew this program was going to go kind of fast because there's just so much information to talk about Ms. Robinson. And when I was thinking about what TV show I wanted to do tonight, I canceled one so we could do this.
Great.
Because I wanted people to know who this woman was, the contribution she made to this community, to this country. Because a number of the young people that she mentored went through her program, it spread it throughout this country.
Sure.
So look how much it helped the country based on these young people, you know.
Yes.
I want each one of you to, what message, about a minute time, what message would you like to leave the viewing audience with? And Ms. Everett, I'm going to start off with you, I know. And one thing I want to say about Ms. Everett, she was talking about, you know, war and distance. You are a gold star mother.
Yes, she is.
You know, and I want to get that out because Ms. Robinson appreciated that so much, and she really made sure that everyone knew who this lady is. This gold star mother is someone that has lost
a son or daughter,
a son or daughter
in the military service.
So we want to thank you for your loss as well, you know, of your children.
You.
I think we may start somewhere else because you're going to have to compose yourself.
Yes, thank you.
Tell me, what would you like to leave the viewing audience with?
Even if you didn't, if you knew her, you knew that even if she yelled at you or got on you about dressing or your people skills or how you were acting, she wouldn't think of you that for the rest of the program. She would, it's a new day, new start. She's gonna, if you're nice to her, you're following directions, you're listening to what she says, she's gonna be there right by you to help you beat whatever you're trying to overcome, like whatever you were in that program for. She's gonna be there to help you graduate and be on top of what you want to do and what you can do.
You know, I appreciate so much you being here, because it sends, you know, credibility to who Ms. Robinson was to have you come on the show as to who you are now and look at you. I mean, you're apparently doing great. I know your father's in the audience, and I'm sure he's very proud of you, you know. Rose, what do you want to leave the viewing audience?
You're great. You're awesome. Ms. Robinson saw that greatness, and she wanted to pull it out of you. So whether you're somebody who's been through the program or somebody who's going to be through the program in the future, we just look forward to bringing out that greatness that's within you. We always need help in regards to donations. So if you have white T-shirts, button-ups, if you have ties, if you could go to Goodwill for us, we need black shoes, we need black socks, brown belts, black belts. Dress code is always helpful to have, because not everybody has access to this stuff. So to donate would be a great pleasure, a great appreciation. Friday nights, we have dinner and a movie. So if you have cash, check, money, order, know somebody who knows how to get us some pizza, anything helps. And we really appreciate you supporting us in our efforts to continue on the legacy that Ms. Robinson left for us.
That's right. The next couple of Fridays, pizza's on me.
Hey.
Okay.
Oh, thank you.
We'll deal with. All right, Ms. Everett, you go, because we got about 4 minutes.
4 minutes? Okay,
yes.
I'll keep it
so
short, because Dr. Ingram needs to wind it up. I just think about two things that JoAnn Robinson offered. First off, she was a great friend. We've lost a great friend. And she taught the students and the parents that somebody loves them and that change is possible. Change is possible for the better.
Doctor?
Yeah. Well, you know, again, something like Ms. Robinson cannot be described with mere words. You know, I would have to play a song, I have to recite a poem, something of that nature. But since I'm not a poet and I cannot sing, I can dance, but I can't sing. All I can say is that there's a verse that comes out of scriptures that said that you must walk while there is light. Mm-hmm. And Ms. Robinson has created a lighthouse here. Mm-hmm. And the light is shining brightly. And all of those students who have come through the program, there's some light in them. There's light in the staff and so forth and so on. And as scripture says, walk while there is light, because in darkness no one can walk. I would love for everybody out there that has a teenager, son or daughter, and who needs some light. Here, light is being used as a metaphor for knowledge, for understanding, to come into the house, enjoy this knowledge that this woman has made available that will last as long as we last, and hopefully beyond that. It's a great opportunity, and to keep this program alive. Jesse Jackson, keep hope alive. I like to say, keep Ms. Robinson alive by any means necessary.
I want to thank all of you for being here tonight, because this night was truly a tribute to Ms. JoAnn Robinson. Such an awesome person, such a loving person. And I want to say, you know, Carol Penning, our clerk, lost her mom about a couple of weeks ago, and Ms. Robinson was so passionate about that, you know, losing her mom. So we're going to give our condolences to Ms. Penning as well. But JoAnn Robinson, there's not a lot that you can't say about her, because you could have another week of this show and still not cover the contributions this lady made to this country. So I want to say thank you for being here. And I want to thank all of our camera people for being here, because without them, we don't do shows like
this.
So thank you for being here. My name is Leroy Brown, and have a good evening.
Thank you.